I want to tell you about Texas radio and the big beat.
It was a warm summer night with our song playing on the radio.
Hi, I'm Susie Ronstadt. Welcome to today's episode of I Remember Radio. On behalf of Mike Kuhnert, our producer, Billy Smith, our technical director, and myself, we'd like to welcome our special guest today, Mike Settle, an amazing singer-songwriter, journalist, and broadcaster. Mike was originally with the New Christy Minstrels and is probably best known for being the founder of Kenny Rogers and the First Edition. Mike has many fascinating stories, how he auditioned Kenny Rogers, how the band was formed, stories behind their big hits, memories of their TV appearances, and why they never let Kenny drive on snowy roads again. Please join me and meet Mike Settle.
Thanks, Mike. We appreciate you joining us.
Well, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to meet you guys virtually, as they say.
What are the very beginnings of forming the First Edition? What were your first activities?
When I joined the Christy Minstrels, at one time or another, I became the musical director after the last of the originals left the group. And we were on the road traveling, and I got a phone call from the management company. And they said, we've got a singer you got to listen to because he's got to take somebody's place in the Christy Minstrels. So we were actually on the way from one gig to another, and we pulled over to a phone booth on the highway. And I auditioned Kenny Rogers for the part, and we had never met, but he was in a hotel, and I kind of assumed, well, he's probably in a hotel room where he's got some privacy, and he'd sing a little bit, and I'd say, oh, that sounds good. Can you sing a little louder? Or he'd sing a little louder, and I said, let me hear some of your high notes, you know, because it was a really high baritone part that he was going to, you know, replace. So at one point when I kept asking him to sing a little louder or a little higher, he said, I'm in a hotel lobby. I said, don't worry about it. You got the gig. You got the chops.
So you hired him into the Christy Minstrels first?
Well, it was actually the management team knew of him because he was in a group called the Bobby Doyle Trio, and they were the opening act for the Kirby Stone band. The management team knew of him and referred him to for me to listen to for the Christies. And then while we were on the road with the Christies, after a while, I was writing a lot of songs, and I thought, these aren't songs that the Christy Minstrels would sing, and I'm not sure that it would really mean much if they did, you know, because it was years after their big success. And so I started singing a couple of the songs in between intermissions on the Christy Minstrels gigs. Terry Williams was in the group, and he would harmonize backstage with me. Next thing we know is we're in New York, and we'd sung a couple things that Kenny heard. And I said, you know, we're thinking of forming a band. And he said, well, I might be interested in that. And at the time, I had just written a ballad called If Wishes Were Horses. And what happened was I got a session set up for a demo, and Kenny and Terry and I sang on the demo. It was a real, you know, quick in and out because we knew the song cold by the time we got to the studio. And as soon as I heard the sound that we made together, I figured, oh, this is really great. And now what we need to do is have a female singer in the band to kind of round out some of the harmonies and keep a little interest, you know, visual interest in the group. And so that's how we came together. And Thelma Camacho was the original female singer. So they had a gig up in Las Vegas with the Christy Minstrels when they were still in the Christies, opening for, I think it was Dinah Shore. And Terry and I drove up and hung out. And in the daytime, we rehearsed songs, and we got about four or five songs that where we had them down fairly well. And Terry's mother was the secretary for Jimmy Bowen, the producer, and she set up a meeting. We sang for him in his office with one guitar, four voices, and he said, go make that demo with Mike Post on Tuesday night down at Western. And we did, and the next thing we know, we had a record deal, we had management, major management. I think by the end of the first week of our first club gig, we pretty much had a whole team together.
Well, that must have had your head swimming.
Oh, it was. It was better than a miracle, because we were dumb enough to not, we probably just thought, oh yeah, that's how it goes, you know? And so we weren't too thrown off base by it, but we knew we had struck a very lucky streak. Right after we did the first time we did the Smothers Brothers show, then we took off in a van and a station wagon with all our gear, speakers and everything, and did a little cross-country tour, stopped at a couple of clubs, and then ended up in New York City and did a show at the Bitter End to wrap up that part. But while we were there, we did the Tonight Show because of the power of the Smothers Brothers management team. They were able to set up some really nice things along the way. I think we did I don't know if it was on the first trip to New York, but we did the Ed Sullivan show maybe that same week. I'm not sure. But we got great exposure.
I found you showing up at a lot of shows. Laugh In, there were a few others too, weren't there?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The Laugh In, there's still a tape of that, and it's kind of a psychedelic, for lack of a better word.
Yeah, and it was, I guess, one of the early examples of a video shoot for a song. And it was, you know, I don't know who came up with the idea in the production company, but we went through a taxidermist's location for a lot of the shots, and it was really kind of cool. You know, I got a story. So I told you that we had gone to New York. On our first cross-country tour in a van and a station wagon, before they had SUVs. They didn't call them SUVs then. So we go to New York and we play the Bitter End, and we did our spot on the, we were on the Johnny Carson show, and I think we did Ed Sullivan that same period of the tour. And we're driving across the country to get to a gig in Denver, Colorado, at a nightclub. And we get to Kansas and it's snowing. And Kansas was wide enough that it got more snowing and more snowing. And then by the time we got into southern Colorado, things were slick, and we're driving at about 10 miles an hour, maybe, driving along. And it's the kind of terrain where it had softly rolling hills. So I was driving the car with Terry in the car, and Kenny was driving the van with the Mickey and the instruments, and Thelma was in the car with us. So we'd go over a rise and then down into a little dip and go for a while, and then we'd see the van come up over and go with that. So we were doing that for about 30 minutes or so, and then we go over another rise, and then we go through a little dip, and then another rise, and another dip. And about the third rise, we're thinking, where the hell are the other guys? So we cut across the highway to get on the other side, and we go driving back. And finally, we see Kenny and Mickey Jones standing outside what looked to me at first, they had hit a slick spot and it rolled over and fell to its side. I'm not used to seeing the bottom of a truck. So it was totally black. And I'm thinking, oh my goodness, it's caught on fire and it's burned. Well, there was no smoke and there were no, you know, cinders or anything like that. But Kenny and Mickey were just, where were you? What, you know, we're freezing out here. We And then we were on the way to this gig, and a guy comes up behind us with a red pickup truck. And he says, "Do you guys need any help? You needed me to call services or anything?" I said, "No, we've got a job tonight in Denver." And this guy, we said, I'll pull you to Denver. So we got all of our gear into his truck, and we weren't pulling our own van, but he took all of our gear, and we all climbed back into the car, and he drove us to the club where we could unload our gear. And I don't remember his name. He didn't want any money. He was just one of those great, you know, hey, anything I can do kind of people. And he did us a huge, huge favor out there in a snowstorm. And anyway, we always used to tease Kenny about one of the things that he said before it all happened. He said to me before it happened, "Now you're going to drive the car for a while. Do you know how to drive in the snow?" And I said, "Okay, yeah, I grew up in Oklahoma. I can do that." And of course, it never occurred to me that he would hit a problem. So that's the overturned van on the way to the gig in Colorado. So on the first album, I had written some songs that we did, and Kenny had found a song that his buddy from Houston, Mickey Newberry, had written. And Mickey was an established writer in Nashville, and the song was called "Just Dropped In," and to see what condition my condition was in. So Kenny asked Mickey if we could have that song for our record session, and Mickey said no. He said, "Kenny, you got to understand that songwriters only have one chance to have any control over who records their song, and it's always the first artist to record the song. And I'm holding it for Ray Charles." And then the story goes that time went by, and we had, you know, already started our album, and Kenny went back to Mickey at a certain point and said, "Any chance we can get that song?" And by then, Ray Charles hadn't responded on it. And so Mickey said, "Okay, go ahead, do it." So we did it. And of course, it was pulled off of our first album. It was on the charts by the time we were driving back from New York. It was quite an amazing stroke of luck.
That was quite a change in genre, too, from the Christy Minstrels to kind of a psychedelic rock song.
We didn't think about genres. We just thought about, hey, that's a good song. I like that song. Let's do that song. And that was the only quasi-psychedelic song, I guess. But I didn't even think of it as psychedelic. I just thought, here's a guy who gets messed up from time to time, and here's what he goes through, you know? And at that time, you know, I guess maybe you didn't tell everybody in public, or you didn't go on a TV show and say, "Oh, yeah, I do a lot of dope, and I drink heavy and all that stuff." But anyway, we just sang it because it was a great song, and Kenny's connection to Mickey turned out to be a goldmine for getting us on the charts and kicking off our career.
You recorded it at Western with most of the Wrecking Crew, or was it just whatever session musicians they had there at the time?
Seems to me that Larry Nechtel played the piano, a famous jazz drummer, Earl Palmer, and I'm not sure who the bass player was. I know that we just had three people in the studio with instruments on that demo session. And then Terry Williams, I think, one of the songs that we did in that demo session was "Ruby Don't Take Your Love to Town." And Terry Williams did the guitar licks on that thing. I think that's the only thing that we participated in with instrumental. And, you know, Mike Post, when we first went to record, basically in those days, we didn't get to play on the sessions because he brought in the Wrecking Crew guys and great, you know, the great rhythm section.
Is there any story on the intro to that, the backwards guitar?
Well, the story is a lot of people tried to do a solo for the intro, and I can't remember whose version ended up. I think it was Terry Williams' also did a solo, but a couple of the studio musicians had done stuff. And then Post was always looking for, you know, new techniques and stuff. And what they did is they turned the guitar track upside down, played it backwards, and then turned it around and put it and inserted it into the mix. So it was like a very clever, unique technique.
One of the first things I did when I got the record, I had a reel-to-reel tape recorder, so I recorded it and then played it backwards. And actually, listening to it in the right direction, it wasn't that much of an intro. Just kind of a real simple guitar riff, but it sounded a lot better backwards.
Well, and also they may have stretched it out, because once they did what they did, you know, recording it backwards, they could, you know, dub and redub and whatever. All I know is it caught everybody's ear, and the whole thing about using a Leslie speaker on the background vocals. Yeah. It was just, they were very inventive.
Did you write their second hit?
But You Know I Love You. Yes, I did.
Yeah.
I started that song. We were on the road, and I came up with the first two verses and a little refrain, But You Know I Love You, Yes, I Love You, Oh, I Love You. And of course, I knew I didn't have a song, but I thought, there's something good about this. And so every day, wherever we were playing or wherever we went, I would sit down pull out my guitar and just sing what I had that I thought, okay, I like it so far. Waiting for something to come right after it. And it took 4 months. And one day we're in Chicago, we check into the hotel, everybody goes to get a cup of coffee. I said, I'll be down in a few minutes. And I played my two verses and refrains, and bingo, the bridge came out. The bridge came out, and I finished the song in the next 10, 15 minutes.
Did you do the lyrics also?
Oh, yeah.
Lyrics and the music?
Yeah. Yeah, I did music and lyrics to almost everything I wrote, except for a few things that I co-wrote with people.
I think you played that on Smothers Brothers, didn't you?
But You Know I Love You? Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And apparently the technicians or the audience or somebody wasn't cued into when the song really ended.
Oh yeah. We had that fake ending.
Well, yeah, and the audience started applauding, and then you just kept going.
Yeah. Well, maybe we took too many beats in between the false ending and the real ending. But that's right. I saw that not too long ago. It was very funny.
What was your experience at Smothers Brothers?
Well, I had known them before I even joined the Christy Minstrels or put together the first edition with Kenny and Terry and Thelma. And we would run into them from time to time. And I remember one story. They were in New York at the same time that I was at one time, and I was playing the Bitter End. So we get through with the gig at the Bitter End, go next door to have a beer at the little pub next door. And Tom Smothers is there, and we're all sitting around the place. And Tommy Smothers did a one-handed handstand in the bar. And then I don't think he drank a beer upside down, but it was, he was a character, I'll tell you. But yeah, we'd known him for a few years. And of course, they really catapulted our career by having us on the show to at least two, maybe three times.
Mason Williams have any involvement in that?
Well, Mason was the head writer of the show, of the Smothers Brothers show. And of course, Mason is the one that brought Tommy to our first show, and they were all of them big fans. And you know, we had, and the managers of the Smothers Brothers were our managers. So it was I guess it was pretty easy at that point for them to say, hey, we want to have these guys for a guest artist. And we did have that song, you know, just dropped in, but it wasn't on the charts yet. So I guess they used a little pressure and got us on, and it really helped break things open.
That probably gave it a pretty good jump start.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Once we did that first show that we did at Ledbetter's in Westwood, it was a folk club. I think Steve Martin was the headliner and we were the opening act. And that was before he was a big star and before we even had a record deal. But I had called Mason Williams and said, because we went to school together in Oklahoma City and we had sung together. We had a little duo for a while. And at this point, I lived in LA and we were still in touch. And I called him and said, I've got a new band and would you come down and see our show and give us some feedback and some, you know, give us the good and the bad. And from that, he showed up, but he brought Tommy Smothers with him that night. And they both thought it was pretty, pretty great stuff. And they went back and next night they brought their management team for the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour and for the Smothers Brothers. And things just started clicking like crazy. And we fell into a really nice spot somehow or another. It was a miracle.
Well, you started out kind of with Mason, didn't you?
Well, in college, we were buddies. And then I dropped out of school after about a year and a half. And I joined a folk group with John Stewart that John Stewart had called the Cumberland Three. So we were on tour with Shelley Berman. And then after that, John Stewart joined the Kingston Trio, and I went back to Oklahoma and twiddled my thumbs for a little bit, and then, you know, got into the folk circuit again and got a gig at the Bitter End in New York out of that. So that's where I ended up staying for about 5 or 6 years.
Did you and Mason perform together in Oklahoma?
Yeah, we had a duo, and we were supposed to be going to a club as a duo, and we had made a little demo, and then Mason got a letter that said, do you happen to recall your ROTC commitment? And oh my God, it was just devastating. All of a sudden, we were both soloists again, and he was trying to see if there was some kind of special services in the Navy that we could just, so he was going to get me to join the Navy, and I would have done it. But they didn't have that kind of thing. So he went to the Pacific Ocean and I went to New York.
And then you lost touch for a while, or Jelly got out of the service?
Well, I mean, I would, you know, hear from him on rare occasions. He'd drop me a line and then as soon as he got out, we got back in touch together. But it was a couple of years, you know, that was his gig for a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember exactly why I ended up back in Oklahoma, but we met up again back in Oklahoma and formed a duo for the second time and had a lot of fun together. And oh, well, when I was in New York, I forget this. I was looking for some way to get out of New York and get to LA. And I spoke to someone I knew who was in the New Christy Minstrels and they were looking for people and to replace some of the original people. And so I joined that group for about a year and a half. And that's where I met Kenny Rogers, Terry Williams, and Thelma Camacho, who was that was the nucleus of the first edition. Terry Williams' mother happened to work for a well-known producer in LA, Jimmy Bowen. And she arranged for us to go do a demo or do an audition for him in his office, which we did. And it was just one guitar. We sang a couple of songs. And he said, you know, I've got a new producer that I've just brought online for my company. And I'd like you to go down to a studio. I think it was
Western Sound.
Western Studio on Sunset. Yeah. Go down there next Tuesday night. Mike Post is going to meet you and he's going to supervise your demo session. And so it seemed to come out pretty well. And we not only had a record deal, we had a producer, and he had not done much that had been released yet, but he produced our first two or three albums, I think it was.
Well, he was a member of the Wrecking Crew before that, wasn't he?
Well, not Mike Post. but he hired everybody who was part of the wrecking crew. There was Hal Blaine. I can't remember everybody else's name, but he was, Jimmy Bowen used most of the wrecking crew on most of his records. And so Mike Post was able to do the same thing.
It's funny how when people mention the wrecking crew, Hal Blaine is always the first one to come up.
Well, he was the loudest.
And he had the most jokes?
Well, at my age, it's hard to remember any jokes that anybody told that far back, but he was a great guy. They were all great people.
When I was reading about that, Mike Post jumped out at me because I remember when I bought the Mason Williams Photograph record, he produced that also.
Right. Well, after we did our album and with Mike Post, then, you know, Mason, of course, heard it and was excited. And he said he got in touch with Mike, and Mike got him signed to the label, and off they went. And that turned out to be a phenomenal relationship.
When I was doing background research, I noticed that you and Mason and Jimmy Webb are all in the Oklahoma Songwriters Hall of Fame.
Well, I was inducted, I guess, a year or 2 years ago. I can't remember for sure, but yes, I'm thrilled to be part of, as a songwriter, in the Oklahoma Music Hall of Fame, along with a couple of kids that I went to high school with. Chick Raines, who was a fairly successful writer down in Nashville, and Barbara McAllister. It was Barbara McAllister, who was also in the Oklahoma Musicians Hall of Fame, was a classmate of mine in high school in Muskogee.
Wow. Quite the musical class.
Well, we got lucky.
Well, another recording I found is in Columbus, and it looks like it was like in a local TV show.
We were playing at the Bistro in Columbus. I guess the guy from the TV station had come over for some reason, and maybe he was invited by the owners or something, and they said, oh, you got to come over and do our thing on Saturday morning. Sure, you know. So we did. You know, we just kind of, I think we were smart enough to stay dumb and just say yes. And things seemed to work out.
And you did quite a few appearances on Mike Douglas too, I think, didn't you?
Yeah, we were on that show two or three times, I think it was. And, you know, those kinds of appearances, and that, there again, though, that was so much the Smothers Brothers family, you know, and their team helping us get gigs by, you know, putting a little, you know, well, if you do us a favor, we might be, you know, available sometime, kind of thing.
They were good friends to have.
Oh boy, they were the best. Yeah.
Have any other interesting Tommy stories? I like the one handstand.
Well, that's the one that jumps in my head the most.
Mason had been with them a few years when they started the show, hadn't he, as a writer?
I don't know whether he was on the show from the very beginning and became the head writer after a couple of years, but I know that he and Tommy were good buddies from the get-go. Mason knew him before the show.
And because I have all the old Smothers Brothers albums, and some of them feature some of Mason's songs, so I guess
they were
working together before the show.
Well, Mason at one point was living in a guest house at Tommy's house up in the canyon, Laurel Canyon, I think it was. And I remember we were up there one time, and Mason had started a new piece that turned into Classical Gas. And he just, I think he just had a little bit of the intro. He hadn't quite got more than about 8 bars so far, but he was showing it to us. And then he asked us to sing the parts, the 4 parts, because the 4 of us were in the first edition that we were up there. So he must have been, you know, he must have been involved with the show at the time. So originally, you know, we didn't really have a lead singer as such. Everybody would be the lead singer on the songs they sang. And after our first big hit with Just Dropped In, all of a sudden we've got, you know, all kinds of publishers and music people saying, you got to do this song or that song. And on the second and third album in particular, we did some songs that came from the outside, but nothing seemed to have, you know, stuck to the wall. Then when we're on the road and I'm spending all this time trying to finish that song, But You Know I Love You, and I'm trying over and over and over and over and over. Well, by the time I finally finished that song, I thought, okay, this is a song that I gotta get Kenny to do the lead, because then I'll have a chance to be the writer of another hit song, you know? So Mickey Jones, the drummer, and I had been harmonizing on that song, you know, the day before. And I wanted to make sure that on our rehearsal — we were working a club in San Francisco, I think it was — and I wanted to get there early so that when Kenny came in, Mickey said, hey, Mike's got a new song, you ought to hear it. So I sang it to him, and he said, yeah, that sounds real good. And I said, you know what? I think this would be a great song for you to sing, because I knew inside that he had to sing the next hit. And so he agreed, and that's what happened. So I wanted to mention something about that song that I wrote, But You Know I Love You. So of all the songs that I wrote, that's the only one that I can say has been recorded over 20 times. It was a hit for us. And then a year later, or a year and a half later, it was a country hit for Bill Anderson. And then 10 years after that, I guess, it was a country hit, number one country hit for Dolly Parton. And
Wow.
And in between, another 17, 18, 19 people had recorded. I get such a big kick out of the fact, because, you know, we were in an era where people didn't do covers anymore. And I'm happy to say that at least I got some coverage. So listening to a couple of old tracks from our first tour, it reminded me that one of my favorite parts of being in the band and being part of putting it together was the fact that our rehearsals were — we all made up our own parts. We had nothing written on paper. And the way we rehearsed was, we would sing a song over and over and over till each one of us thought, okay, I'm happy with my part and I'm happy with your part, where we all felt like we had got as good an arrangement vocally as we could. And they were just all — it was great to work with people that kind of, you know, ear for harmony. I love that.
So we're continuing on with the first edition after your first round, I guess you could say, with Smothers Brothers and Laugh-In. And well, what happened after that?
Well, I was with the band for a couple of years, and then I decided to leave so I could get back home and be with my family, because we were traveling like basically 10 months at a minimum per year, and had been since I'd been in the Christy Minstrels. And it was getting pretty touchy at home with my wife and son. So I thought, you know, family's important too. And
rearranged your priorities.
Yeah, I did.
Now, when did it change to Kenny Rogers in the first edition?
I think it was right after the hit, But You Know I Love You. I know that we changed it for — we did at least three albums where it was the first edition. And then I think the fourth one, that they had Ruby Don't Take Your Love to Town, I think that may have been where it started to be Kenny Rogers in the first edition. Because the DJs had, from the beginning, on the hit Just Dropped In, recognized his voice. And they wanted to hear more of his voice. And when we had first formed the group, we were all doing different songs, different soloists. Mm-hmm. And so it sort of congealed into a lead singer, with, you know, other secondary lead singers.
Was he a lot of fun to work with?
Yeah, oh yeah, we had a blast. Kenny was he was a very funny guy, got a great sense of humor, and he was always, you know, organizing some kind of activity on the road. If we had a day off or a couple of days off, he'd get us all out on a golf course or go riding on a riding trail somewhere, and, you know, stuff like that. He was a goer.
Did you leave the same time that the lady did with the group, about the same time?
No, she left a little ahead of that. She had some a health issue, and she recommended her friend, who had been in a singing group with her, Mary Arnold, who is now known as Mary Miller. She later married Roger Miller, and she just slid right into that slot without a beat. It worked out, you know, very well. And she's a great singer too, and they had a great go.
So how much longer did you stay in LA after that?
Well, I lived in LA until 1994 earthquake. Where we lived, we had to move out. And so we had the earthquake, and 6 weeks later, my wife and our daughter headed to the Nashville area. We settled down in Brentwood, Tennessee, and my sons Jason and David stayed in LA, and there you go.
That earthquake had a lot of effect on a lot of people.
A lot of LA people showed up at the same time that we did. Within weeks of each other, LA flooded the Nashville area with musicians and artists and people who'd been really probably thinking about leaving LA anyway.
What did you do between the time you left the first edition and got tired of the earthquake and left town?
I went on the road and sang as a soloist. I did club gigs and did some, you know, and I kept writing songs and produced a few albums on a small label, and basically just went right on as if I was still singing in the coffee houses in New York City.
When did you meet up with Chris?
Chris was a friend of a friend of mine, and who said, you know, you got to meet this guy, and he's a good writer. And so he and I got together and we clicked, and the next thing you know, we're writing songs together, and Chris and I both worked on the music and the lyrics together, you know. It was sort of a bipartisan thing on both melodies and lyrics, and then we just kind of tootled along. We loved each other, and we still do, and we liked our music. We didn't get the kind of reaction in terms of cuts that we had anticipated, but hardly any writer does.
You know, actually, now that I think of it, I think you did a commercial for aluminum bottle caps or something.
Oh. Yeah, that was so off the wall. This was before pop top cans were really well known. The funny thing is that we were thrilled to be doing a commercial, but when we got there for the shoot, they had a platform sitting in a little small body of water, and it was a little bit windy. And we had our costumes on, you know, the clothes for the show, and we had our instruments on us, standing on this platform that was kind of bobbling a little bit, trying to give them the shots that they wanted. And I guess they must have either gotten what they wanted, or they just gave up and decided to go with what they had. But we were four nervous little guys.
Well, it looks like they drug you all over the farm too, because you're at the Stagecoach, you're at the Bottle House, you're in that raft.
Yeah, well, that was a separate. Those things were okay. That wasn't much of a challenge, but it was being on that bobbling float. That was sort of like, well, okay, in the drink or not. Here we go.
I talked to some of these disc jockeys from 50 years ago, and they say, you know, some of the things you bring up, I haven't thought about that in 50 years.
Okay, I got something else to say. Because you mentioned DJs. So when we did our first tour, FM radio had not become the monolith that it is now. So we go into a radio station, an FM radio station, and they'd sit down, play the whole album, talk to us for an hour. We have a big hit record out of that, and you come back around a year, year and a half later, we're starting to go to radio stations, and now FM is the thing, and it's all we can do to get an interview with the guys that we talked for, you know, through a whole album of stuff with a year and a half before that. So it just shows you how quickly the big time starts to edit itself.
Well, thanks again, Mike. Had a great time talking to you.
This has been a great pleasure for me to reminisce back with some of the early days, because time goes by and some of the most fun you've ever had in your life seems to drop into the background, and it's great that you dug it up for me, and I really appreciate it.
We appreciate you and participating too. We had a great time. Anything that brings us back to the 60s is good.
Well, I just say one more time that, you know, every time something good was happening to me, somewhere along that road, Mason Williams was involved as well.
Whoa, I love you, but you know I love you. Yes, I love you.